Okay, Nathan.
Yes.
Okay. So, dear talents, here we are with one of the guests of honor of RIFF, Laila Palkanina. And before we go any further, we would like to start with a short film about life. And, well, what could we say? It's probably the other side of penalty shooting. You recognize it immediately. And there's, I think I'm not the only one. I know I'm not the only one. But there's so much truth about human beings in this very tiny little film. And, yeah, before I say something, would you like to comment on that? Tell us how you came, this idea came to you?
At first, I would like to say hello. then I want to say that I don't understand football at all. By the way, maybe one of the only times when I was very enthusiastically watching football was when Iceland was playing, because it's like because it's like miracle, yeah. And but it just happens that we were shooting something different, and we had camera, and we were shooting, and it happened. And it was not like a project applied somewhere. Its budget is zero, and it traveled a lot. It started in Oberhausen Short Film Festival, but it was around the world, including football film festival in Brazil. So, because, you know, maybe this is one of my suggestions, if I can suggest something. When you edit and you understand that you can't put everything what is so special, so important for you. You even can't put all the best shots in. For me, editing, in fact, is to just to have the my best, my favorite shots in. But sometimes it is too much, like this one is 2 minutes. And then sometimes what I do, I just say to myself, okay, I'm not going to throw this out. I will make film.
And there is more truth in this than you, even you can imagine. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, it's attitudes and everything, you know, sticking together, you know, fellowship, whatever, you know, giving up, not giving up. It's, wow, it's everything.
And for me, like the most complicated thing in during filming this was not let the cameraman to move camera. Because of course he wanted to follow. Mm. And he even touched one time camera, and we needed to stabilize a bit this. But this was my only, how to say, duty, just to say hold, hold, hold.
I mean, if this cameraman had worked with you before, which I assume he has, then he should know that one thing, that Laila Palkanina never ever moves the camera. Or what?
Yeah, yeah. I never move. But you know, sometimes there are situations. Usually, we like we make a composition and then we wait. Here we made composition, but when you are in very like reportage situation, we don't use like movements. We in frame, yeah. We just you can't, like, if you need to do something fast, you can't switch off and go to next. We do it without switching off, switching on. If it is, like, really hot situation. Mm-hmm. But normally, yeah. And I in documentaries, I would say there are no moving shots, I think so.
I don't recall any in the films that I have seen.
Yeah, but in fiction, well, I have, but not handheld camera.
We'll get back to that probably later on. You know, because, you know, I assume that you have seen at least a few of her documentaries, and they're all very unique, strong, and personal, I think, in style. And her film grammar is very strict, clear, simple, beautiful, I would say. I can say that? You don't have to say that?
Yeah, but... but in fact, it is not so easy to talk about films, about filmmaking.
We do our best.
We could talk maybe, I don't know, about... not my films, other people's films, but when I talk about filmmaking, when I talk about my films or my experience, it's like I feel that this is not me who is talking. Me is someone who is making films, because it's so natural. It's just natural. Talking about films for me, it's not natural. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's another me right now.
You know, this style of yours, I mean, just keeping aesthetic camera, you choose your motifs and then you stick to it, I mean, whatever happens, that also has a consequence that sometimes the main action, if there is an action, happens half inside the frame or just outside the frame.
Yeah, but then they come back.
Then they come back, yeah. Mm-hmm. How difficult is that, or is that exactly the effect you are trying to achieve?
No, what happens. It's just life.
Yeah.
And because I think that you can't run after life. You will be always late if you just will run. It's better to stay and wait it happen. And it always will happen something. Yeah. And unbelievable things happen. I was shooting one film on bicycle road. And it was just normal bicycle road. People were biking and walking, and it was flat. There was nothing, and we put camera, and we were shooting some movement, and suddenly people started to fall, like one after some time, another. It's just... And there was nothing, there was no hole, nothing. It just falling people. And yeah. I can say that when I was sometimes asked question, what I like in film, what is funny thing in film? I'm saying falling people are funny. if you have falling people,
we never
just
grow up.
Don't. Cut them out. It's so funny.
It hurts. That's funny. Yeah. Where does this style come from?
I don't know. Maybe from film school. But no one taught me to do like this. Maybe it was like started from cooperation with the same cinematographer. We were studied together film school, and we somehow somehow started to make films like this. It is not like always the same style. I would not say style, but just some values.
Language, grammar.
You mean?
The visual.
So for us, very important thing when everyone started to shoot handheld, keep tripod, and then when you have tripod, then maybe this style is developing from.
If something is fashion, never do it. Yeah, I agree. You know, you said when you're studying, for those of you who don't know, she studied in Russia, in Moscow. Can you tell us a little bit about, the way the Russians trained you or taught you, or what was important for you? What did you bring home from Russia?
I studied in a very interesting time. It was time of Gorbachev, of Perestroika, where Soviet Union was falling apart. I graduated in 1991, and I think I was one of the few filmmakers of Latvia who graduated in Moscow Film School who studied for free. Because later, so we were already foreigners for somehow it was very good film school at that time. And interesting thing, we were shooting on 35 millimeters every year. And
there's no film school in the Western world did to make, you know, mainly shooting on 16 millimeters. Yeah.
So, I don't know what to say, but what I brought.
I mean, it. You have this. I mean, Latvia was, of course, used to be a part of the Soviet. You know, is there a, you know, how easy or difficult is there a love hate relationship there, or, you know?
Right now.
Yeah, right.
Or in general.
Yeah, I mean, it has been. No.
You know, if I wanted to become a filmmaker, there was no choice. Because it was the only film school for all Soviet Union. And if you wanted to become film director, no choice. There is only 10, they accept only 10 people. It was like competition was like, whoa, just 10 people for all Soviet Union each year. And it is like, wow. But talking about love and hate, I very much separate culture and politics. Of course I learned from all those Russian filmmakers. I learned a lot. I like Russian writers, but I can't say that I like Putin.
No, who does? You studied there and you came. Did you come back immediately after your studies and started with, you know, two empty hands, you know? And can you tell us a little bit about your career, how it started and, you know?
The thing is that for me, I never lived in, can you imagine, during Soviet period in Latvia and all in all the Soviet republics, there were film studios, and there were no filmmakers were no freelancers. They were like working in film studio, and they were having salaries. Even they were not making films.
Nice.
But I never lived in this paradise.
Yeah.
I graduated film school in 1991, so the system was already broken. And so maybe that's why for me it was much more easier than for older ones to continue in totally different system. And also maybe for me it was easier also because at that time I graduated documentary film department, and it was not easy to get financed for films at all. But documentaries, they consider it to be cheaper, and it is possible to make films sometimes out of nothing. And so,
but time, I started. It's time consuming, you know, and mm-hmm. time is also money if you want.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but if you like, if you like what you do, then you find something, you can do something different for
for
your food, for your, and then you just make your films.
Mm-hmm. I'm interested in your working process. I mean, what comes first? I mean, do you have a strict idea? I mean, do you work with, do you write scripts?
For documentaries, never.
Yeah.
But I need to write something. Like in this world, you always need to write those projects, those director's notes, those you know, all this.
Yeah.
It's for me, in fact, I was taught in school that you don't need, it is not possible. No, there are different types of documentaries, of course, but for this type of documentaries I'm making, it's not possible to make to write script. I just maybe even if I don't write, but then I have it in my head. I have plan how I will do it, where I will shoot, for example.
Yeah.
I need to know where I will go.
I mean, take a picture like, I mean, a film like, the first film I saw, I think, by you was, it's called in English, Hello Horse, you know, and it's basically vehicles passing by, cut on action, always in the middle or something, you know, and then we see a lot of mass poles, road signs, trees, horses, cows, dogs, people, whatever. And you work with centralized still frames,
mm-hmm.
you know, and of course, no camera movement. And you... There's strong feeling of seasons in the film. I mean, how would you, because for me, it was the first acquaintance, you see. And I was young, and this is what it is. It's like I approached it a little bit, or it came to me like a poetry in some mm-hmm. way, you know, because I it was not about understanding, you know, it was more about, you know, going, you know, going with you on some kind of a trip, even though we were staying at the same time. But the movement was within the frame, and I could see that you came back to the same places, winter, summer, whatever, you know. How would you describe it? If I was a, you know, rich bastard trying to give you money, or not willing to give you money, how would you pitch this for me?
You are right. I will say how I will pitch, but our problem as filmmakers, and your problem if you want to play this role of, like, let's say, commissioning mm-hmm. editor or whatever, is that we so much consider film as literature, which is possible to describe.
Yeah.
Or journalism, yeah. But at least, of course, we need to use words. For example, I can't sing for you as commissioning editor what I feel, what my film will look like. By the way, this Hello Horse, we have a system in Latvia that there are three experts who choosing to give you money or not, but there are also like three consultants who are representing society,
mm-hmm.
Like all the like different people, And those three consultants, all of them, didn't get this idea at all when it was presented.
Difficult to explain too, with words.
But I will. I. How I would pitch it for you? I would say that I will save your time, and you will not need to stay hours and hours on the road, on remote road in Latvia, in winter, summer, spring. I will save this time for you, and I will compress it for you in, I don't remember anymore, but I think it was like 24 minutes film.
Yeah.
I will compress like 2 years in 24 minutes, and you will have those 24
minutes.
Oh,
that's luxury, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's something, that's a magic that the film can do, absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was for me a very strong, experience. And then, you know, because you're saying, I mean, words are sometimes so limited, you know, at describing a film. And, you know, I think I'm not the only one who says quite often that film is mostly or strong, it's basically mostly related to music.
Yeah, could be, because it's also, the, how to say, develops in time.
And could it be also, because music is, in its essence, it's abstract, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You can't, we have music which we call program music, which is supposed to describe volcanic eruption or whatever, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But it's music. We don't see it. I mean, we have to, actually somebody has to tell us what it's about.
Mm-hmm.
So music, unless you're a very educated musician and can read all the sheets and all that stuff, it talks to your heart much more than your brain.
Mm-hmm.
And in my mind, and that's a good question if you agree, you know, a film should first and foremostly speak to your heart.
Mm-hmm.
And I think understanding is totally overrated.
Mm-hmm.
It's to have a moment.
I totally agree with you because you somehow need to switch off your brain, to open your heart, to
believe,
open your
go
feelings.
With it,
and because I think the totally wrong angle how to watch films is do I understand or I don't understand. Understanding is very rational thing.
Yeah.
I think you just relax and watch, and what will come will come. Maybe it's a problem in Europe or in our so-called Western society. I've been sometimes to festivals in Asia, and I had feelings that because of different cultural backgrounds, they watch films differently. They just come and they listen what is coming to them.
Mm-hmm.
They are not, judging. But also me, when I'm watching film, it's good. No, it's bad film. Already while I'm watching.
It's just take me on a ride and I'm with you or whatever,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's interesting. I mean, yeah. And having seen this film, Hello Horse, I was prepared for the next one. You know, I sort of expected something in the direction. The second film I saw was Snow Crazy.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know how many of you have seen that, but it's one of the first things you learn in the film, there are no real mountains in Latvia,
mm-hmm.
and it's about skiing,
mm-hmm.
you know, okay, that's a good, you know, thing, I thought. And it's, you know, basically or mostly about artificial skiing hills, making snow things, and like a subject like that, is that something, you know, having said there are no mountains, you know, skiing is not the national sport of Latvia, let's make a documentary about that? Or how did that start?
It's something, again, about falling, of course. Because I think that life is funny.
You're a sadist.
Yeah. and when, like, begin of this snow crazy was a bit like maybe the only of my films which came to me like idea, not like something visual, but it was like what. I suddenly understood that this is crazy. People doing so much downhill skiing in the country where highest mountain is 312 meters. And it is just crazy. They even have songs about mountains, but we don't have mountains. And so then I started to explore this. But it comes, yeah, there is some kind of optimism in when you watch around and see that something crazy happened to your
it's some attitude, you know, positive attitude towards life and all its diversity. And me, as I saw it, but talking about mountains, you know, 300 or between 300 and 400 meters, that's double the height of the highest mountain in Denmark. And they call it Himmelberge, you know, means the sky mountain. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like a hill in Reykjavík. Mm-hmm. Sorry, Casper, wherever you are. The bitter truth. Okay, there's one day in a month, you know, okay. So, you know, okay, and then you seem to have some connection with Finland, or at least, you know, because Rasma is... That's a Finnish story somehow.
No, it's Estonian more. But anyway,
we
all have some connections, but not so much with...
It was Estonia, okay. The language, I thought it was, you know, because... Yeah. But was that your interest in this ship? It's about a ship that sinks, you know, sank in 1941, I think.
Yeah.
And it contained basically... shoeing machines and bicycles.
Yeah, and it was like legend. But also it sunk not far from Estonian coast. And then there were like legends that Estonians went with small boats to this ship and they took whatever they could. Yeah. And like many years later, I don't know, 50, 60, more than 60 years later, we were going around this village, knocking to the people and asking them to show their bicycles. Because we wanted to see maybe someone still driving the same bicycle. But of course, it was not about bicycles. Mm-hmm. It was just to have this reason to enter someone's house and ask, show us please your bicycle. Mm-hmm. Because it's interesting to see people, how they're showing their bicycles.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, they're proud. They're showing some property of theirs, you know. Mm-hmm. And, you know, yeah, also. I mean, when you're shooting, more about your process and the filmmaking, I mean, do you have a big crew with you or?
No. No. It's like about football. I don't understand anything about fishing. But that's why we called this talk like fishing in the river of time.
Yeah.
And I don't know how people fish, but how they are fishing, but I feel I'm fishing when I'm shooting. I know that it is possible to make like everything by yourself, to have your camera and to shoot, but I like divide those professions because I like to work with talented people and I like to use their talents And I usually work with, when we go for shooting, I go with a cinematographer and sound, and that's it. Sound is responsible for sound, cinematographer for image. Mm. I'm just fishing.
Yeah, and you know, since you're fishing, has it happened to you that you're shooting something and you find out then afterwards that it's not for the film you thought it would be, it's probably for another film?
No.
Because some of them are free in form, you know, you can sort of expect anything.
The only thing, like, for other film, no. I'm getting ideas also for my fiction films while observing life, but I don't mix material. Yeah, there is. Yeah, you understand?
Yeah, of course.
I'm not taking that for another film, because we are shooting with different cameras. We are every film, even if they are kind of my style films, every film has its own style, and it's not good to mix them. And the only thing when I take, like, with a short film about life, just one which would never fit to the film. 2 minutes, too long.
Yeah, I mean, now we're here basically and talking about documentaries, and most of the people here, they are basically interested in features, I think. I mean, still, but, you know, we know better that later in life you will also open your eyes, or if you haven't, for documentaries, because that's also a very interesting and exciting way to express oneself as a filmmaker. But you do both.
Yeah, I do both, and mostly parallelly. But of course, when I'm shooting fiction, I'm not shooting parallelly documentary, but it somehow happens that when I shoot fiction, when I too much in this one film, I'm starting to miss documentaries. Yeah. And when I'm in documentaries, I'm starting to miss fiction. So I'm making both. And also, strange thing, I graduated as documentary filmmaker. I said life is more talented than me, because life creates those films, not me. And I will never, ever make fictions. And 6 years after graduation, I was making my feature-length fiction. And then strange thing that as I graduated as documentary filmmaker, I made already 3 feature-length fictions. And then I started to make short fictions, because I suddenly wrote script and I understood, but it is for short film. It's like, I think every idea, every script, it deserves its own, not just style, but also length. Mm-hmm.
Are you ever tempted as a documentary director to direct? You know, if something is happening too much outside, try to influence, you know, to...
No.
The frame is there.
No. There is no... sometimes maybe I try to push some birds or...
for example?
When you do something like some animals or something, but not with people. Mm-hmm. Right now I can't say maybe 100%, but maybe it is 100%, that 100% of my shots in documentary films, they are pure documentary. Because I know that it is people mixing, and there are different there are different styles of films, but I have fiction films for staging. That's why I really like to wait what life will bring in my films.
You know, after having watched 6 or 7 of your films, I noticed, you know, we talked about football and the surprises, and you don't know football and you don't even like it, whatever. That's your problem. But but the other thing that, you know, I saw that you, and I guess you care more for, are children. Children are, you know, what is, I mean, yeah, they, a lot about children. In your family.
You know, it's like someone asked me from festival, do I like children? I said, but who hates them? Only those, only sometimes when you're flying with this long distance plane and there is kid who is screaming.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
But then it is like not so much, okay? But otherwise, especially you feel it in fictions that kids never overact. They natural, and they also can. They like. Yeah, it's like I can't say they like animals, but but it's they can create very interesting and mad mise-en-scene for your film.
I mean, if I think about a film like a chimney, you know, we're watching girls basically, mainly, you know, play almost all the film, and you seem to be so close to them, and you know, they're charming. They're, you know, it's the great to be with, and very natural. I mean, whether those kids, I mean, whether your kids or somebody or something, you know, they're so.
We didn't
good.
Know them before. We just put a camera and they started. But it's like maybe not every child would act like this. It just happened like this, and then we understood, yes, we can follow them, but for a certain time, of course. And, yeah.
Did you come back to them? I mean, is it all shot in one day?
No, not in one day. It's like several weeks and with coming back, but I was already telling in Q&As that, and then there was a moment when there were not so much in front of camera, but they started to come behind.
Yeah.
They started already hanging on me and calling me mother and mom. And then it was too much. And then this film starting with this girl with this teeth. She even offered them to me.
All right.
I understood it's so for film you need distance. At least this, 80 centimeters from your lens, but you need distance.
Yeah. As a director also, I mean, you're not allowed to go too close, to be too much involved, because you have to keep your position.
Because I want to observe. I don't want direct or to just ask them to do something. Of course, there was one scene which we kind of provoke. There was nice big puddle, like water. And I thought, okay, it's very natural for kids to walk in this puddle.
Yeah.
And then I put camera and I started to walk myself in this puddle. And they were like it would be magnets, they came and they, but not more than this, not more than
where the chimney was reflected.
Yeah.
The title chimney, was it just chosen because It is there. It's like you take a
it
part
is,
of the
yeah, it
story.
Is there, and they all those houses where those kids live, they
yeah.
are around this chimney.
But what's so amazing and charming about these children, you know, they all have their own characters. You think you get to know them. You know, like the one who's always playing with the insects or the grasshoppers, and they all have a different character, even though they're, and that's
and
that's
not coming for really poor families.
Yeah,
the really poor families, and sometimes I even blaming educational system of Latvia. This girl who was playing this
yeah.
insect, she was already 8. Or almost 9,
mm-hmm.
and she was in school already, second or third grade. But teachers, she didn't succeed with learning her how to read. And
okay.
I think it's because she was so clever girl. Maybe she was like different from others, but I think with all her brain, everything was fine. She was a clever girl, but girls. They were girls just from countryside.
Yeah, wonderful. So, you know, however difficult it might have been for you, but we love them, you know, I think. Guys, I mean, if you if you have some questions, don't hesitate to reach. Yeah, okay, great. Whatever.
I was wanting to know about your use of sounds. Because in the scene where you've got all these people congregating on the mountain, and you've just got this sound of swarming flies on. I just wanted to know more about how you like to use sound in your films.
In fact, then I need to start a bit from sound for me is important as picture, because when you watch films, you perceive them through eyes and through ears, and sound is extremely important. But I had this lack. To work on 35 millimeters when I started, but also we had cameras which were very noisy, and we had I worked on a Russian camera called Convas, which was invented during Second World War, and it was like tractor. And of course, you record sound, but in all your sound material is all the time tractor, of course. And then when I started to make my first shorts, I realized that I need to dub or to find or to create everything. Because it was not possible to use original sound, and as soon as you need to create it, it was boring to create what you see. It is better to create what you feel, what is coming from screen. It's not as rules that you need to, that I need to always put different sound, but it's sometimes like when you make follies, you know that not always the sound of this particular original thing sounds as good as you can imagine, and then those foley masters, they use different crazy things for creating them. And it's the same, like I made film called Ferry. It's not about exactly ferry ship, but like this ferry ponton, or which was,
mm-hmm.
and when it was approaching, we put like sound of earthquake, and different things like this. So I can say that because of this noisy Russian camera, I started to create from very beginning my soundtrack. And even now, when we, of course, recording everything in digital camera, we use always this as base. Sometimes we even throw it out, but we use a lot of dubbing, a lot of editing, additional editing of sound, and yeah.
There was another question.
Point of view or the intention in the stories you choose, because I also found a very big difference with Crazy Snow, Personal Crazy, it's Snow Crazy, mm-hmm. because I found it so journalistic. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if it was your intention, mm-hmm. because you have said you mm-hmm. behave more like an observer than a mm-hmm. director. Do you put any intention in the issues you choose, or?
So Crazy in a way was
a bit different film because it was shot like 2 or 3 years and with different cameraman, and I would not call it more like journalism because there is no voiceover, but anyway, yeah, I understand it's a bit different film, but otherwise about I don't know, my point of view, yeah, maybe it just came to my mind, maybe it's coming, it's all my filming style is also somehow is in connection that I don't like too much to go really close to people. I like making interviews, etc. And that's why I always need this distance a bit. I need this observation. I think that composition can tell you also, not you don't need always go into the face. Sometimes even shooting back of someone, it will also give you emotion. I have one example from one of my very, very first films. I had ideas that it's called Linen, and it's shot in children's hospital. And I got this idea when I saw that there was car. This children's hospital was like in separate, consisted from separate buildings, and there was car collecting like dirty clothes, linens, and bringing back clean one, and of course it's kids hospital, and it's hospital. It's like we decided to shoot like to make film about like pain and suffering, not entering buildings. Just from outside, just shooting windows and just something what we saw on street, and suddenly we saw a coffin because we even filmed twice when parents are coming to take coffins, not kids, but coffins. And it was my first experience like this, and we were staying from distance, and it was not only natural distance for us. We couldn't go further, closer, because it was our distance. No one said you can't go closer. And then it was Right now, I'm not so much showing as I do what I want to do, but before I as there were my first films, I showed like this rough cut to few friends, like two or three, and all of them were saying, no, you need to have like close-ups of crying parents and etc. And then I talked to, we were sitting with my cameraman and talking. We said, okay, if we go to this children's hospital, we can force ourselves, we can go for close-up, we can go with camera into faces of those parents, but we will never use those shots. We will not use them. And we stayed with this. And this is like a school for me forever. What you feel about distance, it is your distance. If you feel for not going closer, then you are not going closer. And maybe it's not always like tragic situations, but maybe it's my approach that I like to observe, but I don't like to ask. I don't like to go too close.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that brings me to my question. I mean, how do you select your subject? I mean, how does it start? I mean, do you see something? I would like to study this, or I would like to observe this, or I always want to know how this or that, you know, is in reality. I mean, where does this come from? I mean, how do you decide? I mean, you can take any film here. I mean, did you,
just happened. Films are coming. Films just come. I think it's natural. It's for everyone. Mm. I have once funny situation. We made a film about one old guy. And it's like, it was really like a natural film came to us. His name is Theodore, and we made this film afterwards, but it was, we were driving on countryside road, and we saw one old man walking, and it was like not so bad weather, and I asked my producer, let's give him a ride and let's stop. And he needed to go like 3 kilometers to the center of the village. And when he went out, I said, it's a smell. It's a smell of urine. It's and my producer said, no, it's something like fish, smell of fish. And I turned to the back seat, and it was wet. And so it's how this film came to us. It's later we realized that this guy is sitting on bus stop and drinking every day beer, and he's not going to the toilet. He's peeing in his pants, and no one from locals never gave him a ride because it's
they know.
Yeah, they know. But we made film about this old man sitting on bus stop observing because it was like his daily life. He went 3 kilometers every day, was sitting on bus stop drinking beer, and we were observing him and observing life with him together.
When you do feature, okay, when you do features, is there a big difference? I mean, I assume you write them yourselves. Mm-hmm. Would we immediately recognize, this is a Pakalnina film?
You would recognize, but there are not you would recognize, but it is different. I very much like mise-en-scène, and for mise-en-scène I also move camera, but not handheld, but in different other ways. And yeah, I write them myself. And they are...
Well, the action is within the frame.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. Okay.
And it's I already in script. When I write script, I write already. It's like already I'm writing storyboards, and then I storyboard it together with cameraman, then be like to go to more precise storyboard. But I follow storyboard very much, of course, with some improvisations what life gives you, because different things can happen. Like light, animals could come, and I'm very much inspired by locations. I can rewrite script when I see during location scout when I see inspiring location.
My question is about the documentaries, the non-fiction films. Are the people who are in those films ever able to see them, or willing, or have they seen them? And if so, what's that like for you and for them?
Yeah, it's they're seeing them. We try to show them, like to invite them for premieres, let's say. Of course, not all of them. Like for Hello Horse, where are those passing by people? Of course not, but if there is someone like particular or few of them, like particular heroes of this film, we're showing them. But I'm the one, I'm not, I'm doing this film, and maybe it is bad, but I'm not continuing a relationship with those people. I'm just cutting, and of course, if I meet them, I'm not running away, but it's not like I'm calling, writing them. It's somehow, yeah.
I wondered if maybe in some cases they might expect a different kind of film than the one that you make.
They always do.
Yeah, I guess that's the case, yeah.
Yeah, but you know, not so much them. For example, but surrounding of them. For example, the old guy I was talking about, now he's already dead, when we were shooting him, there were people going around us from this village and asking why you are shooting him. There are more positive characters in our village.
Better looking.
Because it's somehow comes, I don't know, for television or somehow, that you need to shoot about the best people in a way, but not about most interesting ones.
Showing and shooting, let's say not people for, let's say in this category, doesn't make you think about the power that you have while using the camera on other people's life, or any, let's say, ethical implications on that?
I didn't get a bit.
Can you repeat it? No. Oh.
So in the sense of like not focusing on the people from that the TV wants, right?
Mm-hmm.
And focusing on other people that would consider them interesting, wouldn't make put us or you as filmmaker in a position of power, or like having any moral implications on that?
No, it's just my film. I decide. It's just like it's like maybe it's not good to compare, but it's like books and films and music. We choose different things, and that's the same. Is our heroes or our subjects we are filming. It's good that we are different and we choosing and I think it has nothing to do with power, nothing.
But how do you approach them?
Ah, you mean, okay. It depends. Usually I don't ask, I start the film. But in case when you really need to enter someone's house, I just ask for help. I'm ask them to help me to make this film.
Do you need a written permission from the people? You know, a contract kind of, you know, once they appear in one frame?
It's slowly starting right now. Because it started in May 2018, but it's another issue, you know. Even there is this that you can't show number plates of the cars. Yeah, it's and then we will slowly come to the point that make fiction film is much more easier than documentary.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because of course shooting like small girls for so long time, you need the parents to be agree with this, of course. So this is no this is of course, but when you just have a shot from the street, people passing by, how you can get permissions from...
Difficult. Sorry.
Does he see the film, or the children see the film, or people when you're focusing on one character, not people passing by, are they ever seeing your film about them?
Okay, we had a question there.
Yeah, I was going to ask you if you could talk about collaboration with your team, like who's coming with you to the shoots, what are you working on with people before and after, and do you work with the same teams on both fiction and nonfiction?
I work with the same sound director for all my life, except one film, which was co-production. I was forced to have different sound director, and I think it was exception, the only exception, and I will never. It doesn't mean that I will not. I'm not able to change my sound director. I'm able, but I would like choose it by myself, not by co-producers. But concerning camera, I worked with different ones, for some of them, I have this habit maybe to help a bit with composition, but mostly I choose ones whom I trust, and especially the one with whom I started in Moscow Film School. It is like this, that you even don't need monitor. He understands what I want, and I understand how he will do it, and I work with I worked so far with like few cameramen, and I think it doesn't matter documentary or fictions. For most of them, with most of them, I did both, because I think good cinematographer is good in both. The exception is that right now I'm shooting film on 35 millimeters, and today, at least in Latvia, not every cinematographer can work on 35.
Yeah.
And then, even if you have one, I have, because the guy with whom I started, he's from times of 35 millimeters. But then comes another problem. You don't have any more camera assistants who can work with 35.
Yeah. Who can load.
Yeah.
Load
yeah,
the film.
Yeah, yeah. Because it's very, something very precise work.
It's hand work. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And big responsibility.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. You know, too. Okay, I've heard or I've read somewhere where somebody was comparing you to documentary Kaurismäki or something. That's something that I don't really relate to as such, but I would have said Haneke or somebody like that, because of the way you use your camera. Mm-hmm. And do you yourself, I mean, are there any role models, you know, that you think, I mean, I learned everything or this or that from this person? I mean, is there anybody that you admire, dead or alive?
Admire what?
Is there anybody who you admire, dead or alive, filmmaker?
Yeah, I admire many of them.
Yeah.
Many of them.
Or inspiration to you? And you can see in your work somehow these influences they had on you?
I don't know, maybe. But sometimes bad film influence you even more. Because you see and you understand, wow, and they give money. This is finance. I can do better. And this really influenced you. But if, for example, I like films of Antonioni, Tarkovsky, Fellini, Godard, but those films are already made. I don't want to repeat them. And I think my inspiration comes from books, but not as literature, but as you train your imagination on books, because when you watch films, they're already done. You don't train your imagination. You watch films. I like to watch films, but it has nothing to do with my films later. Mm-hmm. Of course, we are not free from influence, but it is, I would say, not maybe direct influence. Yeah.
Is it important to watch everything, good, bad stuff, or is it that we need to isolate ourselves as, you know, delicate artists, or?
No, I don't know. Like, my way is to watch as much as possible. Of course, I don't waste time for all Hollywood movies because it's too bad. But no, I mean, all not all are bad. I like films. But for example, with all what I'm doing, I'm going to watch Star Wars.
Okay.
Yeah, because it's another issue. I like to watch, let's say, mise-en-scène in Star Wars, because it's another thing that we don't see so many mise-en-scène in European cinema anymore. Mm. They are left in Hollywood, because we have a handheld camera and very boring editing, like those, how it's called, eight? Like if two people, two people talking, then you need to shoot it like this. It is totally boring for me. Yeah. And of course, in Hollywood films, sometimes it's like this as well. Mm. But like Star Wars, I go to watch for mise-en-scène and just to see how much you can do with special effects today and with all those millions.
Okay. Yeah.
In your nonfiction work, when you're setting the composition and waiting for something to kind of come to the frame, what's the longest you've ever waited?
Let's say hour and more, or more, even more than an hour in winter, in really like minus 25. But we had our record is more than 20 hours, but it was, I was not next to camera because it was not possible. We needed to hide. We were shooting, I have a film called Dreamland. It's about dump site, about different living creatures in dump site. And we needed to film owls and who eat rats from dump site. And I couldn't be with my cameraman because it's, then it would be too noisy to people. But he set a camera and he had like shelter and he was staying like pointing one direction more than 20 hours. And without not so much moving. Like peeing in a plastic bottle.
Did you get it in the end?
Yeah.
Okay.
But sorry?
Was the camera running the whole time for 20
No.
minutes?
No. You
didn't.
Was the camera running the whole time?
Oh, no. Because it's...
Stand by.
Yeah. We learned an interesting thing about birds. That you can't move... Because they will sense this. You can't make noise, but you can switch light, and they don't react on light, because it was shooting. Of course, we were shooting in night as well. Owls fly in night, and it came out that you can put your lamps, and when you feel they're coming, you switch light, and they're not disturbed. But as soon as you move...
Good to know.
Yeah, yeah. And also for follies, they also learn for owls that if you put sound of wings for owls, it's totally wrong, because they fly... Absolutely, they move wings, but it's without any noise.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's interesting. Yeah.
Yeah, for your next film.
Yeah.
I hate to tap into this topic, but you are a woman from the Soviet Union, and what was it like back then when you were studying? How did you get the courage or the inspiration to become a filmmaker at that time?
You know, when I grew up, times were not anymore so tough because Stalin died, and then of course there was this stagnation with Brezhnev, but. When I entered film school, it was already Gorbachev, and it was like really interesting times. But I was not thinking about being girl or boy. Can I be a filmmaker or not? But only now, when sometimes I'm asked about this difference being woman filmmaker, is it difficult? I would say. For me, no. I never felt any like discrimination, let's say, like this. But back to film school, I realized that they accepted 10 people in course, and as not written rule, there were no more than 2 girls.
Okay.
And then. Yes, when I thinking back, then of course there was kind of discrimination, but not for me, for others who were not.
But was it because there were less girls applying?
No, I would say it was this understanding that it is like a man's thing.
Okay, yeah.
And now, of course, and I think concerning cameras, cameraman or woman, I think it's now it's changing like drastically. Also because of development of cameras, they are much more lighter. Mm-hmm. But right now it's already, we can't anymore. It's like, I think in normally in film schools, my impression is that there are even more girls mm-hmm. than boys.
Yeah, that's changing. That's changing.
Yeah. Departments
yeah, that's
well.
That's the great news. That's the great news
yeah.
because people used to think that women they could, for some physical reasons, not be cameramen. Mm-hmm. You know, the camera was too heavy or what was mm-hmm. it? I don't know. Mm-hmm. You know, they were very rare.
It was heavy, yeah. but you have. I think women are carrying much more heavier things.
It's just like any other nonsense. You know. There's one in the back. Okay. There's
that your inspiration comes from imagination of reading books. So if you can choose one book to recommend, which one would be?
I would not connect it to literature, but the way how it is written, like, how to say, like training your imagination. Yeah, I'm not thinking talking about plot of this book. Of course, I like many books, but right now, if I need to pick up one, I would say Günter Grass' Thin Drum.
Blechtrommel, die Blechtrommel. Yeah, the Thin Drum.
Thin Drum.
Yeah.
Thin Drum.
Yeah.
And for me it happened somehow because this book came very late to
yeah.
Latvia.
Yeah.
At first I saw Schlendorf's film.
Volker Schlendorf, yeah.
Yeah. And I thought, wow, it's genius. And then I read book and then I understood that book is much more than even this genius
yeah,
Schlendorf.
We should not get into that because books and adaptations,
yeah,
well, that's
yeah. I know.
Ooh, whoa.
I know, but you know, when you think I'm not going to read this book because I already saw film. No.
No, it's a bit, I just
yeah,
say this because, you know, it's so rare, you know. I used to have a picture on my desk. It was a you know comic from an American, you know, guy. His name was Lou Reed. He used to draw for New York Times or something.
Mm-hmm.
And there were two goats, and they were standing on a heap of trash, you know. And there was one of them was chewing a film. Came like, you know, it's difficult to chew it, and it said, well. I like the book better, you know. And for me, this is the truth, you know.
Yeah.
We always say that. Mm-hmm. It's very rare that we say, you know, oh, this film caught it much better.
Yeah, but you know, if we talk about books and films, of course, there are like different worlds, different
yeah.
rules of mm-hmm. making them. And Schlendorf's film, of course, is good film.
It's an achievement, at least. I mean,
yeah.
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
He
but
won an Oscar.
There
right,
are
yeah.
sometimes films
yeah.
we are just illustrating
yeah.
this literature, and what I really don't like in cinema, when I feel that films are made for those who don't read books. Yeah, you understand me?
Yeah, sometimes.
Just,
yeah, yeah.
Just like most easiest, like synopsis
yeah.
or treatment. No, but.
I must quote here one Alfred Hitchcock, you know, who said, you know, we should, when we're thinking about filming literature, or filming books, novels, first we should never, I mean, a film script is. On average, 100 pages or something. A book can be 300, 400, 500 pages. So there we have a great difference, you know, and we never have the time to, we always have to skip so many things when we do an adaptation from a book. But he said then, you know, we should, firstly, we should take novellas, you know, short stories, mm-hmm. you know, very short, and preferably not so good ones, you know, because then we have something to add. Then we have to have a reason, you know. So don't take the best books. They're already a piece of art. They're literature. Why do we have to recreate that? But there are books that speak to you, or stories, not too long, and they're not so perfect in form. But then there's a reason to do it better. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's an interesting approach, I think. Mm-hmm. And it's a... Yeah, I like it at least, mm-hmm. because I, for me, it's a two different forms of art, you know, and it's hard to compare. Mm-hmm. Is the hand raised or what is it, or are you just stretching? Yeah, okay.
So let's say it will be question, but I noticed that there is something like in Poland. I came from Poland. There is something like Kieślowski syndrome, which means that a lot of my friends in film school in Poland are afraid of making documentaries because they are afraid that they are mixing directly with manipulation. So, have you ever, it was ever your thought, like, am I still directing, or am I close?
No, I think I was never afraid because I especially went for to study documentary film. Manipulating, yes. I would not use this word manipulating. But we are using life to cut out what we think we need to put on the screen. But it's not so much manipulation, but using of life. But I think there is nothing bad. It's just we are showing life through our emotions, our in our film language.
Yeah,
and. Of course, if it comes to like political films, it's something totally different.
Yeah.
But I'm not talking about politics at all.
Not this time.
No.
I think we're slowly approaching the end of a conversation.
Yeah, we need to go to president.
Yeah, the president is waiting. You know, it's been a both honor and a pleasure to have you. And, you know... Your films are really worth watching and talking about and whatever. So,
thank you for listening to me because I think it must be not so easy to listen to me because it's not so easy to talk about films.
No, but you did marvelously. You're it's fine. I think.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
So.
So stretch. Let's go to prison.
Yeah. That's good. Okay.